Welcome to this episode of MoveMint Medicine. Thank you for those people that have tuned into previous episodes. We hope you've really enjoyed the content so far. Please remember to subscribe to the YouTube channel and also like and share the videos on Facebook. Please continue to share with your friends, your colleagues, your family, and ask everyone to be involved and make comments. Any feedback is more than welcome. We move on to our partners for the podcast. So thank you to the Fit India Movement. Thank you for your continued support. The Back to Fitness Clinic, which is the clinic that Rajat runs. La Ultra the High, which is the race that Rajat puts together. And the Moving Mountains Within Film, which is the film about the 10th edition of La Ultra the High. So I'll hand over to Rajat, who will introduce today's guest.
Thank you, Darren. And welcome everyone else to the new edition of MoveMint Medicine. And today we have a special guest, Dr. Shashidhar. Very special because he's been up there to La Ultra last year, ran the 55 kilometers up there and really moved his mountains with him to get to the start and then obviously the finish line as well. So welcome on board, Dr. Shashidhar.
Thank you. Thank you, Rajat. It's a great honor to be here, and you've been always a mentor to many of us, and you've really taken the endurance running to a new peak in this country, and we all look up to you for further guidance and training.
Thank you, Shashi. Even though you're on the beach, let's talk about your academic background, your professional background. What's it feel like?
Yeah, just to get started, I'm a ENT surgeon with a training in pediatric ENT, and I'm working as the head of the department in one of the corporates in Gurgaon. And my schedule is kind of crazy. We start our work around 6 a.m. in the morning, and sometimes it would just stretch to 10 o'clock in the night. And it's only the running which keeps me fit to work these long hours, and it gives you the right mindset not to get frustrated and to take everything slow, which is the most primary, what I call as a runner's mindset. If you get the runner's mindset, your job becomes easy in life. So we'll be talking that in the course.
Fantastic. Thank you. So can you give us a little bit of background to your fitness journey? Have you always been involved in exercise and physical activity from a childhood?
That's a great question, Darren. it was only until 2016 I didn't start running or fitness very seriously. I was on the higher BMI and kind of chubby. And medically, I knew everything which I had to be doing, fitness, diet, everything I knew, but I just never did it or always gave an excuse of not enough in time. It was only in 2016 I met with an accident where my whole hand got burnt up, second degree burns, and the plastic surgeon who was attending me was a runner, and he was very optimistic about me. And he said, Shashi, look, you may require multiple procedures, or, you know, you're just sitting at home. Why don't you start running? And I just took it. So the first marathon, while I was having splints and the dressings in my hand, I took it in 2016. I have a picture of that. If you can see this, that one. So I was kind of chubby, and it took me like 3 hours, 20 minutes to do that. It was mostly walking. But the good part of that, the healing went so well because of my physical activity and improved blood circulation that I never required any of those intended procedures, and my whole hand with its flexibility just came back to me. And then I became a firm believer, and I was going through blogs of running, ultra running. Then people like George Varghese, Rajat, these are the people who have started the movement in the country, and we always looked up to them. What next? What next?
Brilliant, Shashi. So, you know, from getting started to running and then landing up at, the Ultra, the 55, just take us through that journey, please. You know, that mindset that it could be done, a crazy, you know, like running that distance in Ladakh where oxygen, and please tell us about all that. Like, you know, what is it like? Why is it so special running there? Why is it different from a Delhi? What did it take for you, the whole journey?
So, you know, the first basic question to ask yourself is, how do you chew an elephant? How do you chew an elephant? The answer is, always you take one bite at a time. So this task is like unbelievable. I couldn't even think that I would ever do it. And all the people who came in your videos were like extremely fit, macho types. And I had like a big tummy and other things, hey, can I ever do it? Answer is no. But then I took it one step at a time. I just made that a point. No matter what happens, I'm just going to give my effort. And being a doctor, you run into problems where time is so limited. And you have to have that runner's mindset is all about acceptance. Acceptance that, hey, things will not go in your plan and you won't get everything your way. But, whatever you can control, might as well make the best of it. And with just that simple mindset, I was able to train myself, register for 10K, then start 20Ks. Then first stepping stone in the mountains was a Mashobra Ultra Run, which kind of gave the confidence you can run in the mountains. And, you have to imagine yourself, like you can't be a leopard or a tiger to take on those mountains. It's not you who can climb the mountains. The mountain allows you to climb on it. So you have that ox mentality, like an ox. You go slowly with the momentum and then charge up yourself and put the effort there, and it kind of pays up. So I think 4 years later, I was able to do the La Ultra. And thanks to you, you kind of gave all those emails and everything, what the preparation should be, and never underestimate those mountains and the temperature and other things. When we started the run, the bad news started to come as the weather was completely hostile. It was never seen in last several years, and there was snow coming up to knee lengths, and there were people who were just dropping out of the race. The 100 kilometer, 111, 111 kilometer, that was just one day prior to our run. And we are like, hey, are we going to do this race or it is going to be dropped off? And, as a runner, you don't have good shoes. If you get the snow shoes, you can't run. And if you get your sneakers, you're going to have the snow going in your shoes. And there was no getting around this problem. You can just cover yourself up with a good jacket, dry clothes and other things. But if your feet get wet, you're done. So we actually had those pictures where the whole night we spent taping our shoes with the Scotch-Brite tape so that it becomes waterproof, and we kind of made the whole preparation for that. And then one of the most positive things which you did for us is the last 2 kilometers, when I think you made a very wise decision where you kind of said, okay, fine, this is what is the peak and you don't really have to go touch the varilla, because it was all super dangerous at that time with snow so high and people could really risk their lives. I think that's one of the things again of the mindset that, you have to accept it and be humble, and it's not about do or die situation there. It's a sport. In the end, you are answerable to the people's lives, and there's no point in trying to finish a run and killing yourself. And that kind of, the sensitivity to the our requirements was a huge help to finish the run. And, there were so many smiling faces, and the kids who were volunteers there, they were just wonderful. They would just cheer you up. They'll get you juices and they'll get you food and everything. And you look at them, they say, oh my God, they care so much for you. Why don't you just keep running and keep moving? If not for yourself, at least for themselves. And that just, the whole environment, it was so motivating that, people would just get 300% of themselves. And the biggest problem was the altitude sickness. And a lot of times you would just go breathless, even taking 5 to 10 steps. And that's where you have to remember that, it's just the next step, just the next step. And if you keep taking that next step, you would cover a kilometer, and kilometers turn into 10 kilometers. And suddenly you realize, hey, it's 9 hours and the race is over. That's what it is.
And what was the biggest takeaway for you?
Biggest takeaway for the life, you would look at yourself and say, I don't have this, I don't have that. Maybe I should get this. Maybe I need big biceps. I have muscles. I need, you know, you're so sometimes unsatisfied by your physical self, but it doesn't really matter. It doesn't really matter. The biggest thing which matters is your health. If you are able to move, that gratitude that, hey, everything today is fine. The sun came in and you took a run, and this is the wonderful thing. Just be grateful to those things. And no matter how big the problem is, you can, you know, attempt it in small parts and deal with it. So same with our lockdown. Even if it goes 3 months, if we kind of keep that mindset, hey, this is just one more day, and it's just like your ultra marathon. You'll have every day a new problem, a new challenge, a new fear coming into you. And you just have to keep that mindset no matter what. I'm just going to keep my effort there. The results may be different every second day, but as long as I keep my efforts, I'm just going to be okay.
So those takeaway messages that you found from the race, how have you applied that to your practice now?
You know, when you do, really don't have time and you have to squeeze in your exercise schedule. So if my work starts at 6, I have to wake up at 4:30 and go for a run. I know during the day, every single minute which I have is important to me. And this is the concept of what we call as fringe hours. So if a case finishes and next case is to be taken in 30 minutes, I have 20 minutes for me to, you know, do something about it. So I would pick up my anesthetist and we'll climb 4 stairs up, or we'll just do planks, or we'll do something there. Or if nothing, you can't move around, just sit and meditate in a chair. So that value of time, which was never there, now comes in because you have so much to squeeze in so little time. And then you realize these minutes, which were just escaping, they're all very precious moments. And we have to live through all of them. Second is smiling. It doesn't matter how bad the things are, how complicated the case is, and how bad is the outcome, you just have to smile your way through it. And if you look at the greatest runners of all time, Kipchoge and other things, oh my God, they smile so much more, even through all those pain. And that smiling will only come to a runner. You know, I don't think so any other person will smile in that much pain. That comes to runners, I think.
Great, Shashi. So that's why I keep smiling and smiling, right? So.
correct. Always.
So, yeah. So tell me, I mean, your colleagues, do they think you're weirdo doing all these things, or how you impacted them? How has it been at the hospital for you?
Yeah, more than the hospital, I would come to the point. It's actually my spouse. And when I was training for it, it was like, hey, you always want your time. And my biggest achievement, more than my career, is I converted my spouse into a runner. And after that, everything in life simplified, because now she understands how important is running in life. And she kind of says, hey, you done 21. That's awesome. Before that, it never really mattered at 21 or 30 or 40. And then we kind of work around each other, trying to give each other space for exercise. And, you know, all those domestic small quibbles and everything, they become so immaterial if both of you are running and both of you have same fitness goals. And in the workplace, people do understand that, you know, if you're a runner or other things, they kind of look to you in a different manner and other things. And when you give a medical advice to someone who is obese and who has sleep apnea and other things, I kind of put my old photographs. Hey, I was this 85 kilograms at some time, and I'm now 72. If I can do it in my busy schedule, you can easily do it as a patient. And they kind of take it seriously. So the patients, they are much more responsive. Instead of a fat, obese doctor giving me a medical advice, if you have a fit doctor, they take it much more seriously. And most recently, which I'll say, we had this surgeries which were under the protective gear. And when you have to wear a mask, I'll just show it to you. This is the N95 mask. And a lot of people don't know it. When they wear a mask, they wear it like this. But if the air is leaking from here and here and here, it's not working anymore. So if you really have to wear a mask, you have to wear it tight. And then you'll realize it's suffocating. It's really suffocating. And on top of that, you have to wear a goggles and another shield and other things. So a normal surgeon won't last more than 30 minutes in that environment. It's sweating inside and other things. And we had to do a surgery for 5 hours. It wasn't easy at all, but you, because you've done La Ultra, you're like, hey dude, I know what it feels like. So I've been there in those hot climates and other things, and we endured. And that was like, you know, one of the things which running is helping me as a surgeon to survive long suffocating periods in masks. And that I can't thank running more than anything for that.
So what were the biggest challenges that you faced in your preparation for the 55? Did you suffer any injuries or did you have any setbacks?
The challenges was mostly, I had injuries when I was overweight, and that would happen right from my shin to my ankle to knees and spine. So everything about me was defective at that time. But then I realized, again, the same acceptance, and you kind of take it slow and you don't try to push yourself too much. Whatever effort you can give, you give it, and then, you know, you kind of spend more time on the recovery part, which is stretching, exercise, core strengthening, which is where Rajat's videos were extremely helpful. As a physiotherapist, he kind of pushed it really good, how to improve on core. That kind of took care of the injuries. Mostly it was the schedule, because I could never keep up with my schedule. I couldn't do it 100%. Whatever my schedule was to run these many miles in a week, it never happened. But if I could do it 70%, I realized that was good enough. So it happens in our life. We make our plans. It never goes 100%. But as long as you're keeping up and showing up, even if you do that 60 to 70%, you're going to be fantastic. Because people who actually finish their whole schedule, maybe about 2 to 5%, I think. I don't think so. It's everybody. But we just get intimidated, and after 10 days, we kind of quit it. Hey, this is not going to work out. Let me try something else. So it's just trying to stick to your schedule, whatever you do. I didn't have any injuries while training for the La Ultra. I was lucky in that way.
Brilliant, brilliant. So as I was saying, even though I'm not a physio, it's okay.
You're not. Yes. Obviously, you're an MBBS. But you're yeah. Your videos about physio are much
So what I wanted to actually bring up was, being a doctor sometimes can be tricky, right? Because you know the dangers more. So about this high altitude training and sickness and all that, with all that awareness, and signing up for this race, how did it feel? How did the colleagues, or what did the colleagues say about it?
Colleagues were like, They kind of push, are you crazy? Are you mad? There's no way you can do it. That's the usual response. And, you know, my wife was supportive on it. If you do it, if you only could do it. So I knew for sure if I couldn't really, if I'm, you know, there's a difference between discomfort and distress. I knew what my body's discomfort was and what is my body's distress sign is. So the plan was, if I'm going in distress, I would just ditch it. And this is the take-home message, is most of the people in a run, everybody has bad kilometers. And when they have those bad kilometers, they think they have hit the wall and they just give up. It is just keeping the same effort during those bad kilometers and you're good. I had a gentleman who was going running with me. He was only 16 years old. And he kind of was about to give up at 24 kilometers. And I had to literally hold his hand and I said, buddy, this is not distress. As a doctor, I can tell you, your pulse is still 140 below. And I had this Garmin, which gave you saturation. I said, you're not hypoxic. It's just discomfort, which is putting you down. Just push a few more kilometers. And after 3 kilometers, and he took a Crocin tablet at that time on my advice, he kind of finished really well. He kind of came fifth, I think. And he was always thankful to me that, you know, aapne rok liya nahi to otherwise I would have, you pushed me, otherwise I would have just stopped the race. So we got to keep moving in those bad kilometers and not hit the wall. That's the thing.
That's brilliant. So what would your advice be to the general public then to try and get fit and active? How would you recommend they started?
So I think Rajat would be the best person to advise that. But my experience is there's just not one component exercise, but actually it's exercise, recovery, sleep and nutrition. All of them are equally important. And when we look at the whole problem, we kind of only look at the exercise part, which is just a very skewed angle. Unless you fix the other parts, you're just going to plateau yourself in a few months and then you're going to lose interest on this. And this is in the times like lockdown, actually, this is the best way where you can make up with recovery. If you have not done yoga or you have not done foam rolls, this is the time to do it. If you never did strengthening exercises, I think this is the best time to improve your core. If you have not done mental training by mindfulness or meditation, this is the time to pick it. If you haven't read the books on running and inspiring books, there's no better time than this. So it's just, you know, you can't control the lockdown, but what you can control is how you spend the time inside your house. And that's my message to most of the people, that this for some may be actually blessing in disguise, because there are only going to be two outcomes. Either you're going to come out of the lockdown totally ripped with a good, nice abs, or you're going to come like a really fat, ugly guy. And the choices you make will determine that. I also advise them to try their jeans every 5 days. They would know where they're going, towards the ripped side or the fat side. So that's a good thing, to try your jeans every 5th day, because we're all in pajamas and shorts and we don't know what we're heading for.
Okay, there was just something to add to that. Is there anything particularly within your specialism which is relevant? So how does exercise actually relate with ENT? Are there any benefits that you see by any of your patients doing exercise?
Exactly. Now that we know the biggest killer, we were on diabetes, hypertension, it's actually now obstructive sleep apnea, which is a snoring problem. A lot of it is related to the fat in the neck and it's to your weight. And people in our country have the conception that walking is the best form of exercise, which clearly is not. It doesn't change your heart rate too much. And even if you walk tons and tons without variation, you may not really get the benefits. So running is one thing which, if done properly under guidance, will really get you out of the sleep apnea. And that's one of the biggest health hazards right now.
Thanks, Shashi. And, you know, summing it up, what would you say, or anything that you maybe missed and wanted to talk about? Anything, please.
I just want to say is all about acceptance and not giving excuses. We will have challenges. We'll have much more difficult times ahead. And you cannot control the environment outside, but the things you control, don't make excuses on them. Just go with it and give your best in exercise. If you have a liberty to run in your compound, you can. Otherwise, use a treadmill or bike, something, do exercise. And that really makes everything much, much more better for you.
Brilliant. Okay, well, thanks for joining us today. It's been an absolute pleasure having you on the podcast.
Thanks, Darren. It was really a pleasure meeting you both. Can I ask Rajat a few questions?
Of course, please go ahead.
Yeah, of course.
I just want to know, what should be people doing in terms for their spine, as in what exercises which you think are going to really help the spine? Because I see most of the people slouching on the couch and watching TV and other things, which is not the great thing for spine. Few tips while people are at home, how can they improve their spine?
So Shashi, what's happening is the most recent research that's coming out is basically saying the posture doesn't matter. So what I mean by that is, for very long, we've been talking about this is the best posture, like, you know, sit like this and sit like that. So effectively now we are saying it doesn't matter. The magic thing is going to be keep changing that posture, whatever that posture be, right? So I'm not sitting, I'm not saying okay. That's slouch. I'm not saying that. But yet, don't sit for long hours. So don't sit for more than 30, 40 minutes. Keep changing that posture. That's important. Earlier, we were very gung-ho about the ergonomic, this ergonomic, that. Again, we realized what ergonomic chairs did was, or furniture did was, it only was ergonomic to the factories or the companies making all that furniture, right? It wasn't doing much to anyone else, right? So what you need to do is you need to become an ergonomic body. I think that's very important. And it comes to the point of, do your muscles have the right strength? Are they controlling, are they stabilizing the body enough? Okay, are they mobilizing it enough? So it comes back to the exercise again, rather than just the, you know, the posture. Posture is a product of what the muscles do.
Okay.
So we need to work with that. We need to get the muscles working better. Again, you know, this is similar to people talking about, I want to lose belly fat and, you know, that's all I want to do and nothing else. It's similar for exercises for the spine. There's nothing like a spine exercise, the whole body exercise. So what I mean by that is squats are helpful for a spine. Doing push-ups, for example, or a plank is good for a spine again. So I think mix mobility and strength together rather than just one thing. So I think that's a misconception that people have, that, you know, which is an exercise only for the spine. It doesn't work like that. Good. Think about the whole body. Darren, please, I mean, if you want to add something to that, please.
Yeah, I think I just want to echo that message, really, that obviously the spine and core region obviously stabilizes both the upper and the lower limbs. So the important thing is to integrate that into those movements. So if it's in the squat, obviously you're going to be stabilizing that area to provide you with that sort of stability for that movement. So yeah, as Rajat was saying, there isn't any particular exercise which specifically focuses on that. It's important to actually do movements that you're going to be doing in your everyday life, but then concentrate on the stability of the core.
Wow. And Shashi, if I can add one more thing, you know, some very simple things. I like heel raises a lot. You know, you would keep seeing me doing those little things, you know, with people. Your calves are very important. Your calves are starting from above the knee, right? Your quadriceps and your hamstrings are starting from above wherever the hip is, right? And people don't realize that. You know, it's actually one level up. So if you're working with these things, like, you know, doing heel raises, doing tiny, mini squats, they don't have to be full range. Get started. So if someone is obese, someone has a knee pain, get moving. Do a little bit of a up and down. Each time someone sits down, that's a squat, right? So everyone is capable of a squat who can sit, right? Your spine can become very stiff. So simple thing again, bend forwards, bend backwards. So bring your nose to your knee. That's a good enough flexion. And then when you're coming up, raise your hands up. That's a good extension there to the spine. So, you know, silly, simple things like that are very effective, which can be done anywhere. You don't have to look for a gym. You don't have to look for extra time. So simply basics, keep the basics right.
I wanted to ask Darren, when things kind of cool down and we may start running again, and I imagine initial days would be like running with a mask or something, how do you see that as a problem or as a privilege if you have to run with a mask, or any precautions we should be looking at when we run with a mask on?
I think obviously people would find it very difficult if they're running with a mask for the first time. And particularly if we're considering that the mask is protecting from any potential infection from the coronavirus, obviously at the moment there's very conflicting evidence as to what benefit a mask actually has, because people's behavior changes when they actually use a mask. So they're more likely to touch their face, and if they're more likely to touch their face, then they're going to be then touching other surfaces and infecting. With regards to running, I think the important thing is that if you are going to be using a mask, just be wary that things will change and they will feel different. So you will feel as if your breathing is going to be different, and just be conscious of that and try and control it as much as you can. And obviously stay within the boundaries that you feel comfortable. So if something does start to feel a little bit more difficult, then just regulate your pace or your intensity accordingly. And obviously then when the time comes when you can release the mask and you get back to usual running practice, then again, don't just go straight ahead and back to the running that you would have done previously. Make sure that you are getting back slowly into the right pattern of running, and that you kind of monitor your breathing and you just gradually build things back up to what you would have done before.
Does wearing a mask and running have any positive effect on, you know, running parameters like VO2 max and other things, or it's just the same thing, just more uncomfortable?
And that's a great question. I think there are, in fact, actually products that I've seen on the market, and I've seen actually people using these in London, particularly on bikes when they're cycling, where you can actually have masks which restrict the amount of air that can actually be taken in. I think, to be honest, there isn't that much scientific literature at the moment to sort of provide any sort of groundbreaking evidence as to whether they're going to be having a massive effect. But yeah, clearly, obviously, if you're wearing a mask, your breathing pattern is going to be different, even if the amount of oxygen that you're taking in is going to be different or not.
Different.
So yeah, I don't think there's any scientific evidence to say that there's a benefit. But clearly, the way in which the mechanics of breathing would work will be slightly different if you are wearing a mask.
I think for me, the biggest loss would be nobody can see me smiling, and the smiling effect of running goes away when you put a mask. That's going to be so sad if I have to run with a mask, because it's important that we keep smiling and raise the hopes and spirits of everybody around us. That's very important.
Yeah, you might have to just draw a smile on the outside of the mask.
Yeah, that could work. That could work. That's a great thing.
All right, then, Shashi, it was brilliant having you over on the podcast.
Yeah,
thank you so much, Shashi.
Thank you. And thank you. I really enjoyed
Darren.
It.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Darren. We really enjoyed it.
Great,
thanks
guys. And yeah, thank you all. And, sign up. Yeah, subscribe to our channel and keep watching and be on the lookout for the next episode that will be coming soon. And thank you, Shashi, again.
Thank you so much.
Take care, Darren.
Thank you, Shashi. Bye-bye.